He was the charismatic pastor, and she was his faithful wife.
He developed a real nice relationship with this wonderful woman.
Along with their children, they formed a heavenly choir.
They all cared about one another, loved one another, and they all sang together.
But a horrifying discovery shattered this gospel-singing family's perfect harmony.
This story is so unbelievable that people think that this can't be the truth.
There was a shock and horror that such a thing would happen.
When investigators pry open this case, they uncover a crime of unspeakable depravity and the story of one God-fearing family's descent into pure evil.
Is this like a movie or something?
Who does that? How could that happen?
Monday, July 28, 2008. As the sun settles over the city of Mobile, Alabama, a team of police officers enters a nondescript bungalow located at 258 Ryland Street.
It was the homicide unit, an ID unit, our crime scene investigators. I had one other child advocacy detective that was with us.
It's down there to the left.
The officers are investigating a bizarre missing persons case. Some 3 years in the making.
Did you say the last door on the left?
It's kind of a shotgun house. All the rooms are kind of off of one main hallway.
At the end of the hallway, there's an unlocked door, but officers can only partially open it.
Something blocking that door. Stinks in here.
It was a freezer. You know, it's a, think of a chest freezer. I want to say maybe 3 feet long.
That stinks.
Officers find the freezer has been taped shut.
What do you think? We open it up?
Yeah, open it up.
All right.
Look in it, and it's just a mass that was humped over inside the freezer.
Officers shine a flashlight inside.
I'll never forget looking into the freezer. Everybody was shocked at what we found.
How did this body get here?
In my mind, I'm thinking, oh man, what do we do next?
To answer those questions, investigators will have to dig deep into the personal lives of two of Mobile's most God-fearing residents, Arletha and Anthony Hopkins. Hailing from Wadley, Georgia, Arletha Best grew up in a warm, loving home.
She always wanted to have a big family. She was also a Christian woman, and so she wanted to find someone who had her own faith and beliefs and also loved music.
But by her mid-20s, Arletha found herself divorced and raising two young children on her own.
Arletha's first marriage didn't last very long, but she did have two daughters by her first husband. But now she's single, she's raising two kids, and it's hard, she's struggling.
Then, one Sunday during church, Arletha laid eyes on the man who changed her life forever, a dashing soldier by the name of Anthony Hopkins.
Hi.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
He was in the military. At some point in Georgia, they met in the church where they went.
Are these your two daughters?
They are. Say hello, girls.
Hey, how you doing?
Anthony shared Arletha's love of music and her devotion to God.
To Arletha, this is the perfect man to have as a partner. She finds someone who served his country, who's into God, who's into the church, who's into music.
They develop a relationship. They end up getting married.
All right, everybody hold hands.
Hold hands.
And God bless our wonderful family that we have here.
This marriage, it's like a romance made in heaven. They're into church, they're into their singing and music. This is a dream come true.
And all the blessings that you put on us, God. Amen.
Amen. All right, everybody, dig in.
As Anthony and Arletha's love for each other grew, so did their family. In addition to Arletha's two children from a previous relationship, The couple had 5 kids of their own.
She's got 2 children, and what does he do? He's a great man. Why? Because he says, I'm gonna take care of your children as if they're my own. And not only am I gonna do that, but we're gonna be blessed enough to have children of our own.
She marries Anthony and she thinks it's great. They expand on their family in addition to her 2 daughters who become Anthony's stepdaughters. And they have a wonderful family relationship.
But one day, Anthony made a surprise announcement.
God is calling me. I've decided to become an interim preacher.
He decided he was gonna pursue a preaching career.
He had a servant heart, having a military background, and then being called in the ministry.
You have our support.
But instead of enrolling in seminary, Anthony chose a different path.
For the Lord says, have no fear of sudden disaster or the ruin that overtakes the wicked.
He moved with Arletha to Alabama and became an itinerant preacher, standing out on the roadway preaching to people at picnic areas or whatever. Basically, they were homeless. But then he felt like that's what God wanted him to do.
We need to act now. Why would you do that? Why would you not help your neighbor out?
Needless to say, Anthony's approach was hard on the family finances. But Arletha never lost faith in her man.
He's not really making any money to support his family, so times are really tough. But Arletha wants to support him because she thinks and feels that he's doing God's work.
I was thinking that hopefully we could bring you aboard into one of our ministries.
The couple's faith ultimately paid off when Anthony was approached by a pastor who offered him a job and lodging at his church in Jackson, Alabama.
God has been calling me since I left the military, and I just think, wow, you know, it's preaching, it's my new calling.
He became more popular with his ministry and was able to start making some money doing it.
Anthony's sermons soon became a hot commodity on Lower Alabama's evangelical preaching circuit.
Would preach on the weekends and on Wednesday nights at these different Pentecostal churches in the area. And he was quite popular.
As Anthony's stature in the evangelical community grew, so did his family's.
They settle in a church, and the family forms a gospel group called the Hopkins Ensemble. And they also travel and sing together while Anthony continues to preach.
They go sing in churches, and all the kids played instruments, and very musically oriented, very, very popular group.
And in 2004, Anthony and Arletha were blessed with more good news.
And all of a sudden, 10 years into their marriage, they find out they're pregnant again with their 8th child.
But that's when tragedy struck. One Sunday, a tearful Anthony took to the pulpit at a local church and made a gut-wrenching announcement.
Brothers and sisters, today with great sadness, I have to report to you, Arletha has died.
When she gave birth, they went to Georgia. She died giving birth to that younger son, and he just buried her there in Georgia, where her family was.
I ask you to pray for our family.
People were absolutely devastated. They didn't get a chance to tell her goodbye. The news was just very shocking to them. Arletha had become such a beloved member of the church community.
But the loss of their matriarch wouldn't be the last tragedy to befall the Hopkins family. A series of mysterious events is about to play out that reveals a dark family secret and unleashes a scandal of near-biblical proportions. Traveling minister Anthony Hopkins and his loving wife Arletha are living a blessed life. But shortly after the birth of their 8th child, Anthony makes a shocking announcement. Arletha has passed away.
I ask for your comfort, for my young daughters, for our family.
She died in childbirth, and he explains to them that they took her back to Georgia to bury her.
He's stuck with a house full of kids. You have to just pray and keep going.
Anthony is confident that through his faith and the support of his family, he'll survive the loss of his beloved Arletha.
It was a single father raising 8 kids on his own, and you see how talented they were playing music and singing, and yet he was doing all this by himself, and everybody was amazed by it.
Let's get those troops ready. Let's go.
Thankfully, Anthony has help in the form of Arletha's oldest child.
All right, did everybody eat?
His stepdaughter, 16-year-old Chantel.
Formation. Come on, get in the right formation.
The oldest daughter steps into play a mother. She feed the kids. She clothe them. She help them with their schooling. She assumes that mother role.
Fast forward 3 years. It's a brisk morning in the winter of 2008. When one of the Hopkins neighbors notices something strange.
The oldest stepdaughter was out there and had no shoes on.
What are you doing out here?
Well, the neighbor saw her walking down the street and said, what's wrong?
Are you okay?
I got in a fight with my dad. It's
cold. She took her in.
Now tell me what's going on, what's wrong?
At first, the now 19-year-old is hesitant to say what's wrong. But as she becomes more comfortable, Chantel explains she's upset with her father.
This boy that I've been talking to called the house.
Young man had found interest in her, and she was upset because her dad got on the phone and said something to that young man, which drove him away from her.
Now the guy won't talk to me.
Those things happen. I know they happen all the time, but I think it'll work itself out.
The neighbor tells Chantel not to worry. That's when Chantel makes a startling confession.
I'm pregnant.
Oh, Chantel.
What Chantel says next practically floors her neighbor.
It's my stepfather.
I'm leaving home because my stepfather has had sex with me and now I'm pregnant.
This is crazy. This is just like unbelievable. I mean, she's just, no, this couldn't happen. No, this couldn't happen. Anthony Hopkins is a preacher.
Psychologically, there's a whole lot, I think, much she'd have to go through. And this was a great big burden on her. And she didn't seem like she wanted to tell it all, but she just wanted to get a little something off her chest.
Chantel, we've got to tell somebody. No. We've got to go to the police now.
No, we can't tell anybody.
And the daughter was like, well, I was always taught, you know, if I say anything against my mother and my dad, you know, God will curse me.
We can't go against my mother and father. It's a sin.
Fearful of what her father may do next, Chantel asks the neighbor if she can stay with her. She agrees under one condition.
Okay, baby, we have got to let somebody know this.
In order for you to stay here with me, you're going to talk to the police or you're going to talk to your pastor. You got to tell somebody this story other than me. So they decided to talk to the daughter's pastor.
Chantel's neighbor drives her to the church her family attends when her father isn't preaching. In the pastor's office, Chantel tells her story again. Only this time, she adds another, more horrific twist.
And I know that he has started sexually abusing my sister. And he used the Bible to make it seem like it was right, but I don't think it is.
She felt that he was molesting her sister, the next to the oldest daughter, because of the way he would give her a certain look. Because he would give her that same look when he first started molesting her.
But after listening to Chantel, the pastor rejects her story outright.
I've known him for over 15 years. There's a demon working in you.
The only demon working in me was him.
Is Chantel telling the truth? Or are these accusations a way for a young woman to lash out against her stepfather?
She did not want her dad to be controlling the child like she had been controlled.
But Chantel isn't done telling her story. And what happens next will ultimately lead investigators to the freezer in that house on Ryland Street. And a gruesome discovery, some 3 years in the making. Years after Arletha Hopkins died during childbirth, the family she left behind seems to be thriving. But in July of 2008, A bizarre string of events calls into question everything people knew about Arletha's husband, Anthony, and their family. It starts when a 19-year-old young woman enters the office of police officer Michael Shavers.
How about you start with your name?
Chantel. Chantel Hopkins.
When she first came in and sat down, started talking to her, she was crying at first. Tears were coming to her eyes, and she was upset.
Okay, Chantel, tell me what's happening.
She had been having sex with her father, and it started when she was younger, probably 11 or 12 years of age. They were inside of a truck driving. He told her the story about Lot and his daughter, that they got him intoxicated and had sex with him, and more or less said, well, it's all right to have sex with your daughter because it's in the Bible.
It's unclear. Did the oldest daughter go to her mom and say, Mom, I'm being abused? Did she conceal it from her mother? Did the mother know and turn a blind eye? Did the mother know and not want to believe what she heard?
Apparently, Chantel's mother initially refused to believe the abuse was happening until she witnessed it with her own eyes.
Arletha.
What are you doing?
Arletha, she's upset.
That's my daughter!
They was in this church bathroom and she just happened to walk in. She saw him feeling on her. They got into this big fight and argument.
How could you?
Arletha, calm down.
That's my daughter. I saw you touching my
Arletha,
daughter.
Nah, that's not what you saw.
Anthony vowed he would never touch Chantel again. But Chantel claims it wasn't long before her stepdad broke that vow.
He enjoys apparently what he does. He gets the proper payoff for what he does. Anything that we enjoy enough, we will normally continue.
The sex continued even though they were in counseling for it. That it slowed down for a period of time, but it still continued.
Calm down, baby, calm down.
It's a chilling story. But is it true? Corporal Shavers has his doubts.
This can't be true. You know, it's just too outrageous.
A lot of times, stepchildren lash out. It's a way of manipulation to get what they want.
Is she trying to get back at him? Is she trying to get him in trouble? Or is this crazy story really the truth?
In order to determine if Chantel is telling the truth, Corporal Shavers asks her a few more questions, starting with her mother.
We didn't know anything about Arletha other than she had died in 2004. So we're more or less closing up the interview. And I just asked her, I said, well, tell me what happened to your mother.
And she tells him that my mom is dead and her father killed her mom.
He killed her?
Mm-hmm.
When?
About 4 years ago.
Okay. What did he do with the body?
In a freezer in our house.
Okay, hold on just a second.
The story sounds too bizarre to be true, so Corporal Shavers reaches out to homicide detective Kent Quinney.
Yeah, what's up, Sarge?
Young lady says her mother was killed by her father, and she's in the freezer.
When Detective Quinney hears what Chantel has to say, he has trouble keeping a straight face.
Say that again.
My reaction is like, this can't be real. Maybe she's exaggerating a little bit to make her story seem more real, but that's a little far-fetched.
Of course, the story appears to be preposterous. This can't be. The abuse enough is something that would cause the police to be in disbelief, but a murder?
After speaking with Chantel, Detective Quinney does a little digging and quickly finds a more logical explanation for Arletha Hopkins' death.
Yes, Pastor Jones, Detective Quinney.
I talked to several preachers. One of the pastors that I interviewed said that the wife died in Georgia giving birth.
But there is one family friend who claims to have heard a much different account of what happened to Arletha.
She went out to California as a seamstress to work with movie stars or something to that effect.
Why would Pastor Hopkins provide two such wildly different accounts of what happened to his wife? Did Arletha die in childbirth, or has she moved to California? Hoping to get to the bottom of it, Detective Quinney gives Arletha's parents in Georgia a call.
They more or less told us that they had been isolated from Arletha. They had tried to call her, and every time they tried to call her, Anthony would say she can't come to the phone, or she's not here, or something like that.
In each of these calls, Anthony never mentioned Arletha moving away or dying in childbirth.
This family tried for months to reach out to their daughter, to their sister, and couldn't get her. And I think they eventually gave up and just thought, she doesn't want anything to do with us.
These varying accounts of what happened to Arletha certainly raised some red flags. In order to get to the bottom of what really happened, Detective Quinney circles back to Chantel and her astonishing claim.
She just made the story up, the hyper molestation story. But of course, we got to go over there and check it out anyway.
That afternoon, Detective Quinney and a team of officers head to the Hopkins residence, hoping to speak with the pastor and, if need be, search the house. But not even the most seasoned investigator is prepared for what awaits law enforcement inside the Hopkins home. Police in Mobile, Alabama are investigating startling allegations against Pastor Anthony Hopkins. His 19-year-old stepdaughter, Chantel, claims the pastor has been sexually assaulting her and that she is now pregnant with his child.
She drops this bombshell. She's making accusations about things that have taken place over the course of several years. And the first question is, if this is true, how did all of this go undetected?
But Chantel's sexual assault claim is trumped by an even more jaw-dropping allegation that Pastor Hopkins murdered his wife, Chantel's mother, Arletha.
He killed her.
Yes.
And has been storing her body in the family freezer for over 3 years.
You don't think of things like this happening in Mobile, Alabama. You know, it's just something you see on TV. It's like a movie or something.
Investigators hope to question the pastor about these allegations. But when they arrive at his house, Pastor Hopkins isn't home. But Chantel lets them in and leads them to a utility room near the back of the house.
It's right down there to the left.
Something blocking that door.
It had its own door. Once you open that door, the freezer sits behind the door. You can't open the door fully. You had a slight stench, not a strong one, but a slight stench. And then the flies start to gather. So many times you have a decomp body, flies gather around that house. Thoughts in my mind's like, oh my God, it's real. She's telling the truth.
CSIs cut the tape and slowly open the lid on the freezer.
They had the freezer open, and all you could see was the edge of a hand with two fingers, because the rest was just a big ball and sheets. But you could still see the palm of a hand with two fingers sticking out.
They learned that the story that they were being told by the stepdaughter was not, in fact, a story, it was reality.
A forensic team is called in to examine the body, but there's not much they can do until it thaws.
They had to get a hand truck and wheel the freezer out and then take it to the lab and figure out how they were going to take a next step.
As the freezer is transported to the lab, investigators race to find Anthony Hopkins.
At that point, it becomes a, let's find him, find out where he's at. That becomes our focus.
But finding Pastor Hopkins is easier said than done. According to Chantel, her father had left town to preach earlier that day.
The stepdaughter ended up telling us that the vehicle that he was driving was actually purchased from one of these companies that sell cars that put GPS locators on the vehicles.
Investigators contact the dealership to obtain the vehicle's GPS coordinates. They also run a test to determine if Chantel is telling the truth about her pregnancy.
I'd contacted the DNA center. The oldest daughter ended up having the DNA test.
If she's telling the truth that her father is the father of her child, there's probably truth to the rest of her story, that her mother was killed.
But it will take several days for the results of the paternity test to come back. In the meantime, investigators turn to Chantel to find out just what happened to her mother. Chantel tells them that in December 2004, just weeks after her mom gave birth to the family's eighth child, her parents got into a heated argument.
I know you've been touching Chantel.
I ain't been doing nothing.
Yes, you have.
Whatever started that fight that night, it had to do with her daughter and the fact that her daughter was being raped.
I'll call the police.
You
better
not call nobody.
Get out of my house.
I ain't going nowhere.
Get out of my house.
She threw him out of the house and locked all the doors and told him he's not coming back to the house.
I'll be back.
Get out.
I'll be back. Chantel.
Chantel claims that later that evening, she heard a tapping on her bedroom window.
What are you doing outside?
Anthony Hopkins was knocking on the window. And when she went to the window, he said, let me in my bedroom.
Why didn't you go to the front?
She kicked me out.
Why?
It's complicated.
You guys got in a fight?
Yeah.
Pastor Hopkins convinced Chantel to let him in. But Arletha overheard the exchange.
Chantel! Did you let him in?
And she recognizes Anthony's voice, and she bangs on the door telling him, come out of there, come out of there.
Open up this door!
According to Chantel, another fight ensued.
What are you doing here?
Shut up! Shut up, get in there!
You have to leave!
I don't have to do nothing!
Push Alita's into her room where the kids hear a bunch of arguing and a bunch of knocking around, her screaming for help. Call the police, call the police. He's trying to kill me.
You have to go!
You ain't going nowhere.
Get out!
Chantel claims she ran into the room to break up the fight.
What are you doing?
Get out!
She sees Anthony over Alita's head, and her feet was kicking back and forth like she was trying to get air.
All of a sudden, the pleas and the cries are silenced.
Moments later, Chantel's father emerged from the bedroom and asked Chantel to help him do the unthinkable.
Come on, come help me bury your mama.
They take her then an hour or so north to Jackson, Alabama, and they dig a hole behind one of the churches where he preached.
Chantel says at that point, she and her stepdad rolled her mother into a shallow grave. But a few days later, the pastor started having second thoughts.
Chantel, I'm gonna need your help again.
And asked Chantel to help him move her mother's body.
God wants your mother to be with us.
She had obeyed her dad so long and did things that were so unusual until she just followed the pattern. She developed a pattern of obeying him, and that's what she did.
Once they get there, her body had bloated at this time, and it broke the dirt off the ground where she was coming up. So he digs her back up to bring her back in Mobile.
When Anthony and Chantel returned home, Anthony directed Chantel to the utility room and the freezer he had recently purchased.
As the daughter described it, Arletha wasn't a really small woman. She didn't really fit in this freezer, and Anthony Hopkins actually jumped on her body to make her fit.
It's gonna be all right. She's gonna be here with us right now, okay? This is what God wants her, okay? It's gonna be all right. She's home now.
I think this control over the children was exactly what he wanted. And his wife, no doubt, would not accept it. And since she would not accept it, I'm sure she had to go.
But investigators are thrown for a loop when they receive the results of the autopsy report.
Forensic doctor wasn't able to determine what the cause of death was because of the way she was deteriorating when she finally defrosted.
The forensic report is a setback, but it doesn't slow the detectives down for long.
The investigators are moving full speed ahead. They're going to get the results of the paternity test, and then they need to find this pastor because they want to question him.
But But bringing Pastor Anthony Hopkins to justice will prove trickier than investigators ever imagined. Pastor Anthony Hopkins and his wife seem to have a picture-perfect, God-fearing family. But that facade comes crashing down in horrific fashion when their daughter, Chantel, comes forward with a shocking story of incest, rape, and murder.
People are stunned as this story begins to unravel. It's the pastor. It's his wife. It just defies logic in everyone's mind that this family could be holding these secrets buried for so many years.
After finding Arletha's body in a freezer inside the Hopkins utility closet, authorities were now desperately trying to locate Anthony Hopkins.
The oldest daughter advises that they have purchased a car, one of those car lots that keeps a tracking device on it. You know, if you don't make your payment, they're able to shut it off and come and repossess it.
One of the other investigators ended up calling and getting a number to someone that owned that lot, evidently, and ended up pulling the GPS information up off his home computer.
The GPS traces the vehicle to a church in the rural town of Jackson, Alabama. When officers arrive, the parking lot is nearly full.
We walked into the front door, and what I realized, it was a foyer. There was another set of doors that led into the sanctuary. So we were able to look through the doors, and when I first saw him through the doors, he was standing in front of the congregation. He was preaching to folks.
Brothers and sisters, today's our sermon is about forgiveness. We have to forgive each other. You not agree, brothers and sisters?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody's perfect here.
I made entry into the church, and then all of a sudden he stopped preaching and it got real quiet. And everybody in the church was watching me, and I approached him, and when I asked, was he Anthony Hopkins? He said, yes, I am. Immediately, I put him down and put cuffs on him.
Sir, what is this?
Place your hands behind your back.
What is this about?
As I was patting him down, he was continuing to ask me, you know, what was this about?
What kind of travesty is this?
The more he asked me, the more frustrated he got. After about the third or fourth time, I said,
I guess he's got something to do with that body in the freezer.
What?
Put your hands behind
your
back.
What are you talking about? I didn't do anything.
Relax.
I didn't do anything. Let me go. I didn't
Relax.
Do anything.
Officers transport Anthony to the Mobile Police Department, where detectives attempt to interview him. But if they were hoping for a quick confession, they were sorely disappointed.
We were going to try to talk to him, but he had already lawyered up at that point in time. He had said that he didn't want to talk.
Anthony's lack of cooperation is problematic for another reason. Despite finding Arletha's body inside a freezer in their home, investigators are having trouble piecing together evidence that fully supports Chantel's story.
They could not prove that this was a murder case because of the state of the body. Too much time has passed away, and there's no proof that Anthony caused any intentional act to cause her death.
Further complicating matters is the fact that Chantel's sister, Tasha, contradicts nearly everything about Chantel's story when police take her formal statement.
She's pretty much in denial about everything, and she pretty much denies anything was going on between her and her father at that point in time.
But just when it seems the case can't get any more convoluted, detectives uncover a crucial piece of evidence.
They ended up doing a subsequent search of their bedroom. They found a diary that was written by the second oldest daughter.
She had this personal journal that had some wishes that she wished would come true in her life.
She wanted a closer relationship with God and wanted to have a better relationship with her father without having sex with him.
That journal tells a different tale, a tale of a person who internalized what was happening to her, was her way of expressing it by putting it in the journal, and of course, corroborating the story of the older daughter about the miserable sexual abuse.
I think this child probably developed at an early age to make herself numb and not have no feelings about what went on. And it may take a long time before she really have those feelings.
But Tasha's journal isn't the only piece of evidence that bolsters Chantel's statement. The paternity test results are back. They confirm Pastor Anthony Hopkins is the father of Chantel's unborn baby.
There's no denial that they were having sexual relations because the 19-year-old was pregnant at the time, and the DNA results show later that it was Anthony's child.
Our concern goes from, wow, this is true, to, okay, we've got to get him before he hurts any of the children.
The Hopkins children are placed in the custody of Child and Family Services. And Pastor Hopkins is placed in county lockup.
He was charged with murder, rape second, sodomy second, and incest.
When we find out this happened in our community, man, it just devastated everybody. Him being in the ministry, or so-called being a Christian, makes this worse.
On April 6, 2010, Pastor Hopkins' trial begins.
Your Honor, members of the jury, the state intends to prove, without a shadow of a doubt, that this man, the defendant, Anthony Hopkins, using his vocation as a pastor, manipulated, planned, and controlled to rape Chantel.
He didn't mind using the Bible and manipulating and mischaracterizing the Bible to even justify his relationship or his raping of his daughter.
In addition, to murder his wife.
The prosecutors, they were trying to make him out to be a monster.
As for a motive for these heinous crimes, prosecutors argue this case boils down to one thing: control.
He was their God. He was their provider, and he had total control of all their lives. They were brainwashed. They had no influences outside of what he told them.
We will use facts, witnesses, and testimony to prove these charges.
According to prosecutors, once Arletha discovered the dark truth about her husband, she threatened to turn him in. In response, Anthony decided to take her life.
Arletha and Anthony had been fighting for quite some time over her daughter. And basically, Arletha had walked in and caught Anthony Hopkins molesting her daughter. Perhaps she threatened to go to police, and, you know, he shut her up.
You call the cops, I'm gonna kill you. You ain't going nowhere.
You have to go. Get out!
Prosecutors then call the state's medical examiner to the stand. In grim detail, the ME recounts the discovery of Arletha's body.
It appears that it went through several temperature changes or fluctuations, potentially. It may have thawed some and then refroze.
Of all of the autopsy photos that I've seen, none of them stand out to me like this one did. Arletha Hopkins is literally a block of ice.
As powerful as it is, the medical examiner's testimony presents the defense with an opportunity.
The body's been frozen for almost 4 years. Is there any signs of blunt trauma?
Not that we found.
Why are you saying it's homicide? What about ligatures where there's, you know, marks like looking of strangulation or something on the neck?
Not that we were able to determine.
I can't rule out that she died of natural causes.
So you really don't know what caused death?
No.
The body was frozen, is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Then how can you say that this case is a homicide? I don't quite understand how you can say that.
Having scored big in their cross-examination of the ME, the defense takes a gamble and calls Pastor Anthony Hopkins to the stand.
So raise your right hand.
My jaw dropped. In all the murder cases I've covered, I don't think there's another defendant here locally that's taken the stand. Nobody anticipated Anthony Hopkins taking the stand. And when the defense was presenting their case, looked at each other like, what could he possibly say? The case that the prosecution presented was so damaging, so gruesome. I mean, it was just full of crazy, horrifying details. What could this man possibly say on the witness stand?
Well, when he took the stand, everybody leaned forward. They wanted to hear what he had to say. We had a packed courtroom and everybody started listening.
After being sworn in, Pastor Hopkins tells the court how much he loved Arletha.
Oh, wow. Arletha was fantastic. She was my angel. I loved her.
And how his faith allowed him to persevere even after his wife's tragic death.
I would never hurt Arletha. She's the best wife ever.
We want to try to let the jury know this man used to be in the military. He's a family man, had kids that love him. There's more to the story than what the DA is saying.
Pastor Hopkins also informs the jury of something most folks didn't know about Arletha, her poor health.
The lady was overweight, had diabetic problems, high blood sugar, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, did not take care of her diet, ate a lot of fried foods, and was sedentary a lot in her lifestyle.
Well, what was the cause of her inexplicable death?
It was her health.
According to Pastor Hopkins, health problems claimed Arletha's life in December of 2004.
He left, came back, and she was laying on the floor, and he tried to help her, and she was dead. He doesn't know what caused her to die. I don't know if it was a heart attack, blood pressure.
But why the freezer?
Well, God wanted me to be with her. God told me that he wanted her near me, and I wanted her near me also. I couldn't stand to be without her, Arletha. I loved her.
He said that if he had called 911, then the family would have been split apart. He said that for the good of the family, he had to just hide her.
You know you're accused of rape as well.
As for the rape charges, Pastor Hopkins admits to sleeping with his stepdaughter, Chantel. But he tells the jury their relationship didn't begin until Chantel was 16, the legal age of consent in the state of Alabama.
I'm absolutely sure. I never raped anybody.
He described a night that he said she essentially seduced him, is how he said it, you know, happened.
His wife had been dead for 2 to 3 years, and he hadn't been with a woman, and then his daughter walks in there in this chocolate negligee, and he just, his emotions took over.
One thing led to another, she came on to me.
You're saying she initiated the relationship?
I never would have done that. I know I'm a man of God.
Folks in the court can't decide if the pastor's testimony is heartfelt or just plain disturbing. Either way, it appears to have sown the seeds of reasonable doubt with the jury.
He manipulated this family for so long, he felt that he could manipulate the jury.
But just when it seems the case has tilted in the defense's favor, the state calls a star witness of their own, one who will spell out in no uncertain terms what a monster Pastor Hopkins truly is. After Pastor Anthony Hopkins' gripping turn on the witness stand, it appears the momentum in his murder trial has swung toward the defense. But no sooner has he left the stand than prosecutors call their own surprise witness, Hopkins' stepdaughter, Chantel.
She was very emotional. We had to take breaks for her to gather herself. It was just so emotional. You couldn't help but believe what she was saying, because she was so detailed.
Did he ever touch you in a way that was uncomfortable or inappropriate?
Chantel tearfully recounts for the jury the countless sexual assaults she endured at the hands of her stepfather.
He started when I was 11. We would have sexual relations.
Was the relationship with the defendant and yourself consensual?
No. No.
The oldest stepdaughter talked very openly about the relationship, the rape with her father. And she told the jury that this started when she was 11 years old. And she didn't hold back on any of those details.
So, Chantel, shifting gears a little bit, how does this relate to your mother's demise, her murder?
She found out what we were doing. She confronted him.
The oldest daughter, I think that was the most effective testimony of the trial. She was the key witness. Her testimony was so emotional that it had members in the jury crying. It just had everybody crying. And even the defense was crying.
It got emotional, yes, it did.
In the end, Chantel's testimony proves to be the deciding factor. On April 9th, 2010, the jury finds Pastor Anthony Hopkins guilty of murder, rape, sodomy, incest, and sexual abuse of a minor.
Guilty on all counts.
People were happy that justice was served. These kids could somehow put the pieces of their life back together and try to move on.
It takes the jury an hour and a half after deliberating to reach a verdict that he's guilty. And you have to think, certainly, it will never, ever bring his wife back, the mother of his children back. But what a sense of relief for that community. that a person, a monster like this, a person in the face of evil, will be put away for some time to come and got what he deserved.
The judge sentences the pastor to life in prison, plus 51 years. But even with Pastor Hopkins behind bars, the fallout from his heinous crimes continues to reverberate.
Their mom is gone, their dad's gone. Who will they believe? Will they be able to ever trust anybody? Since these were the closest people that they ever had.
Perhaps the saddest fact of all is that Arletha's longing for a godly man, a soulmate to be with through all eternity, would one day cost her her life and ruin countless others.
You just have to think about how a person with a beautiful family, beautiful children, and everything in the world going for them, how could it possibly come to this? And when you think about it, it's heartbreaking, it's gut-wrenching, it defies human comprehension, it defies logic, it defies decency and humanity. And particularly when it comes from a person of God, it's just sad, it's stomach-turning, and in fact, it's disgusting.
People have to live with the consequences of these crimes, and it reverberates throughout the community. In this particular instance, not only was the immediate family affected, the church family was affected, the community and the neighborhood was affected.
This is one of the biggest cases that affected my life because it's involving men of God, which we call preachers. And after this case, it affected me greatly. I didn't want to hear another preacher preach. It was hard for me to attend my church. It didn't shake my faith in God, but just the faith in man that God called. Because now in my mind, I'm wondering, are you truly called by God, or is there something you're hiding?